Well, I'm excited about the message this morning. I want to share with you this morning probably the most famous chapter in the Bible. It's not only the most famous chapter, but it's also the most famous psalm in the Bible. Many people who don't know the Bible at least know this psalm or part of this psalm. It's called Psalm 23. We all know it so well. And the danger with something that you know well is that it loses its impact or its effect upon your life because you know it well and you start seeing it as ordinary or common, and you kind of overlook it. And we do the same sometimes in relationships. We get to know somebody so well that we just take them for granted until maybe one day they're not there. And so what I want to do today is we're going to just unpack this psalm a little bit, have a look at it and what God is trying to communicate to us. Now, you're also going to see in this psalm there are quite a number of metaphors. God often uses metaphors to help us to understand things better. And so, for instance, I'll give you a couple of examples. When the Bible says the hand of the Lord was upon Elijah, it doesn't mean that God's hand was on him physically. It just simply means that God's favor and his blessing, protection, and provision was upon Elijah. When the Bible says in Psalm 91 that he will cover us with his feathers, under his wings we will find refuge. Again, it doesn't mean that God is a bird. It's a picture of what a bird does, how a bird protects its little chicks. And it's saying to us, in that same way, that same protection that the bird gives, God will give to you and me as well. So let's have a look at that very first verse. David starts off, it's one of David's psalms, and he says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." Now, we'll get to that second part just now, "I shall not want." I want to focus quickly on the first part, "The Lord is my shepherd." So the metaphor or the picture that David is using is of the shepherd, and obviously if there's a shepherd, there's sheep. Now, I have no problem with him referring to God as the shepherd, because obviously God is the shepherd and we are the sheep, and I have no problem with that because the shepherd is the one that watches over and helps and protects and all of that. But then he refers to us as sheep. Now, I know sheep are nice and cuddly and soft from a distance, but I don't know if you've ever really touched a sheep. Up close, it smells, and it's not that soft and cuddly at all. And they're dumb. They're really stupid, really. And they're slow, and they're defenseless, and all of that. So is David saying that we're dumb? Absolutely. Because in comparison to God, we are pretty dumb. We think we're smart. I mean, we can put a man on the moon, and we can do open-heart surgery, and we can delve right into the earth through all our mining equipment and stuff, and get out minerals and metals and stuff like that. We can do all of this stuff, and we can't even contain a tiny little virus. You see, in comparison to God, I think we are pretty dumb. Now, the similarities with sheep don't end there, because sheep follow one another just as we do. Because, you know, we look at one another and, oh, you know, she's wearing this, I also need to go and get that. Oh, he's driving that. Oh, and suddenly you're unhappy with what you're driving. You weren't unhappy yesterday, but now because he's driving, then I also need to. You know, did you hear they put their kids in that school? Maybe we need to look into that. And so what happens? We follow one another just like sheep do. Here's another similarity with sheep. They're pretty vulnerable. Now, if I had to ask you, do you think we're vulnerable? Maybe before the lockdown and before COVID-19, maybe if I had to ask you this question in January, your answer would have been maybe a little bit different to what it is today. You would have said, I don't think so. You know, I've got a good business. It's been around for many, many years, maybe even 100 years or something like that. Or, you know, I've got a very good job, or, you know, I've got all these degrees and qualifications and stuff, or you say, you know, I've got all these investments, and then suddenly a little virus comes along and messes everything up just like that. And so we find ourselves pretty vulnerable. Now, I think that sheep analogy is pretty accurate, especially with reference to ourselves being sheep. But what about God being the shepherd? What does the shepherd do? Well, if you think about a shepherd watches over the sheep. He protects the sheep because they have enemies. They are very much vulnerable. And then the shepherd also takes them to pastures where they can feed, because a sheep typically just puts its head down and he feeds right there. So if he's in the karoo where the grazing is very sparse, he'll just feed there, right there where he is. And he may not even know, just around the corner, just over the hill, it's nice and green. And that's what the shepherd knows. The shepherd can see further. The shepherd knows better than the sheep. And so the shepherd helps them and takes them to where they need to be. The shepherd also helps them when they're in trouble, when they're in a ditch or something like that. The shepherd will go and help them. That's why Jesus says, he says, the good shepherd leaves the 99, will go after that one. And so what David is saying here, he's saying, he is my shepherd. So really what he's saying is, he is my helper, he is my protector, and he is my provider. Those three things, that's what David is saying. And so David starts, and I think it's very, very significant. He starts this whole psalm making a declaration. He declares, he is my helper. He is my protector and my provider. He makes a declaration. He says, he is my shepherd. Because you see, every single one of us has a shepherd of some form or another. Your shepherd may be drugs. It may be alcohol. It may be your job. It may be another person. It may be your investment. You see, it's the thing or the person that you turn to, the thing or the person that you see as your security. And David says, yeah, he says, he is my security. He is my shepherd. And so that's what he declares right in the beginning of that psalm. That's the declaration that he makes. Now, do you know that Jesus repeats the shepherd metaphor in John chapter 10? Verse 11, listen to what he says. Jesus says, he says, I am the good shepherd. And then he says, the good shepherd sacrifices his life for the sheep. What does that mean? Jesus is saying here, he says, you have no idea how committed I am to you. And then he draws, he makes an analogy here. He says, a hired hand will run when he sees a wolf coming. He will abandon the sheep because they don't belong to him. He isn't their shepherd. And so the wolf attacks them and scatters the flock. You know what he's saying is, he's saying, I'm not a hireling. The hireling runs. The hireling doesn't sacrifice, doesn't commit. He says, I'm not like that. He says, you need to know that I'm committed to you. You need to know that I am for you. Have you ever found yourself in a situation where you weren't really ready for it? You didn't really have what it takes, and you didn't have the competence for that. You just really felt incompetent at the time. Here's the good news. You have a shepherd. You have somebody who's for you. He's very much for you, and he wants the best for you. Now, that also means that if he's for you, he's against anything or anyone who's against you, who comes against you, who wants to disadvantage you. Listen to what the Bible says here in Isaiah 59. It says, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against him. So whenever something comes against you, especially the enemy, The Bible says God will rise up. The picture that I have, it's almost like a mother bear or mother lion. You mess with their cubs, man, they're gonna come in. They're gonna retaliate big time. And that's what it's saying, is God is so much for you that even if the enemy is against you, man, God is going to come up against them. There's something I want to show you quickly about that verse, because you see, our English translation is not very accurate, because the comma is in the wrong place, and the placement of the comma is crucial. It makes such a big difference. Now, that verse usually reads like this: when the enemy comes in like a flood, comma, so the power is in the enemy. He comes in like a flood, comma, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against him. Now, that's how we usually read it. But if you go back to the original Hebrew language, you'll see that the comma was actually in a very different place. It should read like this: when the enemy comes in, comma, now here comes the power, like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against them. And so what I want you to see, that God is not only your shepherd and my shepherd, but he's a powerful shepherd. And when something comes against us, God just raises up that powerful standard to help us. And so my prayer today is that this will become a reality in your life, that God is for you, that God is committed to you, and that God loves you. That when you put your head down on the pillow tonight, that you will know that you know God's for me, that God's committed, and that God absolutely loves me. Because the Bible says his love endures forever. His love endures forever. Oh, Leonard, where does it say that? Well, which one of the almost 100 references do you want? Because do you know that that line, that phrase, appears in the Bible almost 100 times? Why would it be in the Bible so many times? Why would God have so many different authors put it in again and again and again? It's almost, if you miss it over here, then you're going to get it over there. And if you miss it over there, you're going to get it next place. And if you miss it there, you're going to get it in the next place. But God wants you and me to know that his love endures. His love endures. That he loves us, he loves us, he loves us. And so here's the application. I've shared that with you because there's an application. How do we apply this in our lives? The fact that the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. How do we apply this? Well, you see, when you know that God is your shepherd, and what does that mean? It means that he's for you, he's committed to you, and he loves you. It also means that he's your helper, your protector, and your provider. When you know that, when it becomes a reality in your life, guess what happens? You have no problem to bring your needs and your requests to God. David says, he says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd, therefore I shall not want. Or because of that, he says, I shall not want. Another translation says, I lack nothing. And so when you get that, when you understand that God is my shepherd, you don't pray routine prayers anymore. What are routine prayers? Routine prayers are those prayers that you pray the same thing again and again and again. It's almost like saying grace at the table. You know, it's almost like a little rhyme. You wake up in the morning maybe and you've got the same. You don't pray like that anymore. You pray specific prayers. Lord, I need turnover in my business. God, I need to make the payments on my motor car. God, I need your help. God, I'm desperate. Oh, God, I need your help with a conflict in this relationship. Oh, God, I need to make a big decision. So what happens? You start praying specific prayers because you know that God is your shepherd. Now, if you want to check whether you are seeing God as your shepherd, in other words, your helper, your protector, and your provider. If you want to check that, it's very easy. All you've got to do is just see if you're praying specific prayers. Because if you're not, if you don't come to God with that boldness and that confidence, clearly you're not seeing Him as your shepherd, your helper, your protector, and your provider. And the Bible says in James 4 verse 2, we have not because we ask not. And so God wants us to ask. And Jesus tells us again and again in the New Testament, He says, you've got to ask. You've got to ask. Listen to what He says here. In Matthew chapter 7, He says, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. In John chapter 16, it says, until now you've not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive. And so it's very clear from Scripture that it's our responsibility to ask. Provision is His responsibility. He is the good shepherd. But you see, our responsibility is to come and to ask God. Now, I want to take it a step further. Listen to what it says here in Matthew 7, verse 11. It says, if you then, though you are evil. Now, that simply means though you are human, you are sinful. That's what it means. If you then, though you are human, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask Him? I want you to notice two things here. Number one, it says, we as earthly parents don't only provide for our children only what they need. We don't give them the bare essentials. We bless them. We give them extra. So in other words, we don't only give them what they need, but sometimes, often, we give them what they want. And so what Jesus is saying, now hang on, He says, if you, though you are just human, sinful parents, can do that, can bless your children and give them good gifts, He says, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts? So God doesn't only want to give you your needs, provide your needs, but sometimes He'll even give you your wants. He wants to give good gifts. And that verse continues, to those who ask Him. To those who ask Him. So what it's saying is, God wants to bless you. Just like you want to bless your children. It says God wants to bless you. But it's only going to happen when you ask Him. You've got to ask. And so the main thing I wanted to share with you today is that God is your shepherd. And that He's for you. And He's committed to you. And God wants to bless you. He wants to bless you. And when you get that, when it becomes a reality in your life, you have no problem to come and to ask Him and to believe that He's going to do that. Listen to what the Bible says in Mark chapter 11. It says, therefore I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe. Believe that you've received it and it'll be yours. So don't come and ask and think, oh Lord, I'm not so sure that you want to give me this because I don't really need it. No. It says when you come and ask God something, believe and it'll be yours. Now, where does that believing, where does that faith come from? It comes from knowing that He's your shepherd. When you know He's your shepherd, when you know that He's a good, good Father and that He wants to bless you, then you come with boldness. Then you come with confidence. Then it's not a problem. And so this is what happens when we ask God for something. We come with a request or a need or sometimes even a want. And then down the line, God meets that need. It may not happen immediately. It happens down the line. And then it builds our faith. So it's the need, God answers or provides, and it builds our faith. And so the more we ask, the more God can answer those prayers or requests, and the more it builds our faith. And so your faith can only grow when you give God the opportunity to answer your prayers. Your faith can only grow when you give God the opportunity to answer the prayers. And so the more you ask, the more God can answer. And the more your faith is going to grow. Now, I know some people feel that they can't come and ask God for just anything, because some of the things that we're concerned about are small, they're little. But let's be honest, everything is little to God. And if it's big enough to worry about, then I think it's big enough to pray about. If it's big enough to just be concerned about, then it's big enough to bring to God and to commit to Him. So let's say I'm having trouble with my stomach and I'm battling, oh, but I can't ask God for this. Of course you can ask God for that. If you're concerned about it, pray about it. Because worrying is not going to help, but prayer will. Just a concern is not going to sort it out, but prayer can. And so God wants us to pray about it. Now, some people think it's too small. Other people think, I don't know if God really cares. I don't know if God's really interested in my little needs. And let me tell you, that's an insult to God. Because I'll show you from Scripture that He does care. And I also want to remind you that the Bible says in Luke chapter 12, it tells us that God knows the very hairs on our head. And mine is a zero, by the way. And so that's how much God knows about us. That's how much God cares. But listen to this. It says in 1 Peter 5 verse 7. It says, give all your worries and cares to God, for He cares for you. And so notice, it doesn't say, bring the big worries, but don't bug Him with the little stuff. No. Bring all your worries. There's something that's been concerning you. Bible says, bring it to God. Bring it to Him. He can do something about it when you bring it to Him. Listen to what it says in Philippians 4 verse 6. Do not worry about anything. Now, I looked up the word anything, and it actually means anything. All right? Do not worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Pray about it. So if you're concerned about your business, pray about it. You're concerned about the country and the government, pray about it. If you're concerned about one of your children, or you're concerned about your business or something like that, or your health, or whatever it is, pray about it. You've got a big decision to make, bring it before God, pray about it. All I'm saying is, nothing is too big or too small for God. Give it all to Him, because He is the Good Shepherd. And God wants to meet our needs. Now, let me just clarify something. You may not get your answer, or you may not get that need provided for straight away. I think if God had to give us everything we asked, every time we asked straight away just like that, we'd be a very selfish, self-centered kind of people. And so sometimes God doesn't give it to us straight away because He wants to test our faith. Sometimes God wants to see if we'll trust His timing. And so we've got to know that we can ask, and as Scripture says, keep on asking. Every child has to learn the difference between no and not now. When the child comes and says, Daddy, Daddy, can we go to the sea? And the daddy says, not now. Okay, that's not too bad, because it's a delay, it's not a denial. And sometimes when we come to God, there's a delay. God is basically saying to us, not now. Keep on asking. Keep on trusting. It's going to happen down the line. Maybe it's not the right timing. Now, here's the last thought that I want to share with us for today. And I think it's the most important thought. I've left it to last, left the best to last. Let's go back to Psalm 23, verse 1. And doesn't look like we're going to get beyond verse 1 today. All right. So it says, the Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. That's the NLT translation, or the New King James. I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd. Can you see what David is doing here? He says he is my shepherd. It's referring to his relationship. Now, when you go and have a look at the Apostle Paul's writings, his epistles, or or another word, just the letters that he wrote, you'll find there's one phrase that comes up again and again and again. It's almost his most favorite phrase. I think the key to his whole theology is tied into this one phrase, in Christ Jesus. You read it again and again and again. In Christ Jesus. What does that mean? It simply means that we are in his family. He is mine and I am his. And David comes and David says basically the same thing. He says, the Lord is my shepherd. He is mine and I am his. When you and I say that, when we come and we say, the Lord is my shepherd, it's referring to my position in Christ. The fact that I'm a part of his family, that I belong to him. Now, listen to what Philippians says. Here's the last verse for this morning. Philippians 4 verse 19 says, my God, Paul says, my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. There's that same phrase, the same line again, in Christ Jesus. And so what it's saying is, my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory because you are in Christ Jesus, because you are in his family. And so it's a promise. It's a promise. It's a promise given to believers. It's not for the unbeliever. Because you see, it says because you're in his family, he'll supply all of your needs. The unbeliever can't claim that promise. Now, most people, when they quote that promise, they'll quote it, my God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches in glory. And they leave that last part out, in Christ Jesus, because we don't quite understand, what does that last little bit mean, in Christ Jesus? That's the condition. That simply means because we are in his family. And so we have a beautiful, beautiful promise because we are in his family. And David understood this. David got this when he said, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want, because I'm in his family, because I belong to him. He says, I shall not want. He will supply all of my needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. And so all I wanted to do today, this is it. All I wanted to do is remind you that you too have a good shepherd. Just like David could say, the Lord is my shepherd. You and I can say, he's my shepherd. I'm in Christ Jesus. I am in his family. And I know that he's my helper, my protector, and my provider. I know that he's for me. I know that he's committed to me, and I know that he loves me. And when we get that, we have no problem to come to him with our request and to do what Jesus said, to come and give all your worries and cares to God. Pray about everything. And so that's what we're going to do this morning. I want to invite you to pray with me now. And we're going to thank God, number one, that he is our shepherd. And that we're part of his family. What a privilege. And because of that, we have the promise that says he'll supply all of our needs. And then I want to give you an opportunity. There's something on your heart. There's something that you're concerned about. Bring it to God right now. Lay it at his feet. Give God the opportunity to do something about it. Let's pray. Father God, we want to thank you so much that we have this privilege to call you our shepherd. And together with David this morning, I can truly say, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. God, you are a good, good father. You are a good, good shepherd. And we just want to come this morning, just pause for a moment and just say, thank you so much. Thank you that we are part of your family, that we are, as Scripture calls it, in Christ Jesus. And now, Lord, we just want to bring these requests, these concerns, and maybe for some of us, even worries. You tell us, do not worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. And so we want to do it now. Won't you mention it to the Lord? Just that concern, that person's name, whatever, whoever it is, just mention it to Him. Just go ahead. We lay it at Your feet. And we come with a boldness and a confidence, Lord, believing that You can change the situation. And thank You, Lord, in the right timing, it's going to happen. Amen. Bless you.
And to worship you.